Our guest today is the Executive Director and CEO of Metra. Our guest today provides direction and oversight to all areas of Metra's billion-dollar-plus operating program and capital program, plus the administrative side, too. But here are some of the disciplines: engineering, transportation, mechanical, safety, operations training, certification, and regulatory compliance. Ladies and gentlemen, Don Orseno. Don?
Well, welcome. This is my third time at City Club. Jay, I want to thank you very, very much. It's always a pleasure to come in and talk to you and talk in front of this group. It's absolutely amazing. Before we even start, Dorval and I go back a ways, and Dorval, I consider him a very good friend. When you just mentioned the $1.1 billion, I said, Dorval, you're going to help me out here? He says, we aren't that good of friends. So I had to regroup a little bit. I went back and I said, you know, this isn't working like I had planned. And I said, you know, they got him taking notes on me and asking questions. So I did the only thing I could do. I immediately told Jay, when he speaks, I want to be there for him. I want to give him a little payback. So hopefully this will work out well. Okay. All right. Thanks. What I'd like to do right now is introduce our chairman, Norm Carlson. He's our new board chairman. Norm, if you would stand up for 1 second. Norm brings a lifetime of experience and knowledge to the Metra system, and we're very, very glad to have him. Next, I would like to acknowledge our immediate past chairman, Martin Oberman. Marty, if you would stand up. Marty was the chairman during some tough times. In case you haven't heard, we had gone through some tough times in the past, but don't worry about that. That's in the past, and we're moving on to the future. So that's a good thing. Next, if I could ask our board of directors that are here today, Rod Craig, John Plant, Don DeGraff, and Steve Palmer. Thank you. Thank you. Kirk, you were already mentioned, but you know you can't mention you enough. You're a longtime friend, and you're a real champion for transportation. I want to thank you, Leanne, also my counterpart at the RTA, Dorval Carter, which remember, Dorval, we're good friends, and TJ Ross. TJ, are you back there anywhere? I thought you were here. But anyway, TJ Ross. Together, all of us combined, we are the Chicago Transportation Unit. We work together very, very closely. That's not always what had happened in the past, but it is what's happened in the past 4 years. And working together and trying to do what's right for the transportation system, not only for Chicago, but also for all the counties that surround. It works together. It intertwines together. It provides people with opportunities for employment and things like that. And that's one of the things we can never forget. That's why it's so tough when you think about some of the things that are going on right now. If you can't get your arms around transportation, you're probably the type of person that doesn't really believe in motherhood. It just is one of those things that no matter who you are, transportation touches everybody's lives. I'd like now to ask our Metra staff, the people that are here from Metra, to please stand up so we can acknowledge you for the great job that you do. I'm taking a little note. We can operate with less in the future, so I just want to make sure if we're all here and we're not there, we couldn't do more. But absolutely, these guys here and ladies, I can't tell you how proud I am of everything they do every single day. I get the opportunity to talk in front of a group like this and talk about all the good things we've done and where we're going. It's not because of me. It's because of them and the staffs that they lead. So once again, thank you very, very much. This is my third year as the executive director at Metra. I've got 33 years at Metra, and I've got 43 years in the railroad industry. I know you can't believe how young I look. I know, hold down your comments, but I've got a lifelong career in the rail industry, and it's very, very important to me. I just wanted to give you a quick rundown. Many of the people know about Metra, but they might not know some of the details. I'll give you a 30,000-foot view of what Metra's all about. We operate through the six-county region, 3,700 square miles. We have 1,155 miles of track. That's enough track to go from here to Disney World. We have 241 stations, 823 bridges, 571 rail crossings, and 24 rail yards. This is a massive system that needs to work together. It's in a complex operating system. I've talked about that before. The Chicago network, this just isn't our network. It's all of the freight railroads that we have to intertwine with every single day. There's about 1,300 to 1,350 trains that operate through the Chicago terminal every day, and over 700 of them are Metra trains. That means we've got to have intense coordination with the freight railroads, because when you're talking about moving commerce from the East Coast to Chicago, the West Coast to Chicago, and traversing through Chicago, that's not an easy task with the infrastructure that we have out there. I'm proud to say that Metra has about 2,800 to 2,900 employees itself. If you count the BN and the UP, we're about 4,500 strong. And I'll talk a little bit later about some of the things that we do and why we're so proud of some of the projects that we're doing in the on-time performance. I want to talk a little bit about what we're looking at, our vision, our mission, vision, and goals. That's very important to us. We put together recently, we've been working on it for a while, you know, our mission, our vision, and our goals. You can't run a large organization without having that type of infrastructure, that type of foundation in there. The board approved the mission, vision, and goals. They said this was something that we needed to have and move it forward. We're moving that through every corner of our organization. It doesn't make any difference if you're turning a wrench on a locomotive, if you're a senior leader, if you're collecting tickets on the train. If you don't know what we're all about, we're not going to be able to deliver good customer service. I'll talk a little bit about our mission statement. As part of a regional transportation network, Metra provides safe, reliable, efficient commuter rail service and enhances the economic and environmental health of Northeast Illinois. That's what we do. We operate through Northeast Illinois. Our mission statement, or our vision statement, it's pretty simple. It really is pretty simple. We provide the safest, most efficient, reliable service to our customers, sustaining our infrastructure for the future generations, your kids and your grandkids, leading the industry in achieving continuous improvement and facilitating economic vitality throughout Northeast Illinois. Who isn't on board with that? Please raise your hand and we'll show you the door. Isn't that something that we really, really, really want to be involved in? With these mission and vision statements, we've identified five categories. Now, these categories aren't in any specific order. So, you know, we can sit here and talk, you know, just so everyone knows, safety is always our number one priority. Safety is always our number one priority. But we didn't put them in any specific order because without one, you don't have anything. And we want to make sure we get the whole pie together. We talk about prioritizing safety, security awareness, investing in our workforce, ensuring financial stability, and delivering quality customer service and optimizing capital assets. That's really what we need to do in order for us to move forward. Our strategic goals are purposely not in order, like I said, so we can go through these individually. Here are some of the highlights from 2016, and I'll start with the first one, deliver quality customer service. We have an easier website that we can use. It's not a complicated website. Several years ago, we didn't even have a website. But what we've done is we've made the website much easier for our customers to use. They can get information quickly. They can find out where the trains are at. They don't have to worry. It takes all the guesswork out of it. Not only did we come up with a redesigned website, we were able to do it for about $400,000 less every year, which is a savings to our customers and our taxpayers of Northeast Illinois. We also tested new seats on a small number of cars this year, and we decided, and we'll decide later this year, whether we're going to move forward with the new seat design. We've gotten some feedback on the seats already, and we're making some modifications, so when we go into the next phase of the new seats, we've incorporated what the people are asking us for. That's very, very important for us. If we don't listen to our customers, we're not going to be around very long, or our customer base will continue, or will start to dwindle, and we don't want to make that happen. We completed the successful test of Wi-Fi. I think everybody understands we were looking for Wi-Fi several years ago when we went through several gyrations, and then we got one bid. When we talked about it, it was like $70 million, and I got to be honest with you, folks. If we had $70 million, we're going to be spending it on locomotives and cars that are 64 years old. But we understand it's important for our customers. We wanted to make sure that we were able to come up with an interim solution. We tested it on 12 cars. It worked very, very well. And we incorporated another 50 cars into it, and we'll have to make an assessment later if we're going to continue to go in that direction. We're also looking for partners, so if anybody is liking to partner with us on funding Wi-Fi, let me know after the meeting, and I'll make sure I get your card and put your money in the hat. That will help us out a lot. The last thing I want to talk about as far as the customer service, we introduced the Ventra app, us, the CTA, PACE. We all work very, very closely with the developers of the Ventra app. I'm proud to say the Ventra app has exceeded all of our expectations. We were expecting to have about 20% after a year. I'm proud to say we've got over 30% of our tickets being sold on the Ventra app right now. It's just absolutely amazing. Just to give you some numbers, sheer order of magnitude, we sold 1.2 million tickets in November. Over 371,000 of those tickets were sold mm-hmm. through the Ventra app, so we're very, very proud about that. What's ahead for 2017? Continued achievement of 95% on time or above. That's always been our goal. We want 95% or above. I'm proud to say we're going into our 22nd month of 95 or better on-time performance, and that's not good enough. We're going to continue to make those numbers grow. Just so someone that may be riding a line might say, well, my line seems like it's a little bit later. We take that with all of the lines and combine it, so when we match it up against our peer agencies, that's how they look at it, so we do apples to apples, oranges to oranges. But anytime we fall below that, we are looking every single time to find out what we can do better to make sure that that doesn't happen again. So I just want to tell you that we are really working hard to keep that on-time performance up. We continue to upgrade the performance of the Ventra app. I talked about that a little bit ago. Among some of the things we're doing, we're looking at a redesigned mobile ticket and a regional trip planner. That's to come later on, and we're very, very excited about it. We try to identify ways to improve customer service with undercover audit teams. What we did is we've deployed several audit teams that we have going out there riding trains all over the system at different times of the day and night and on the weekends. What we wanted to find out is what are our customers experiencing? How can we make it better? And I'm proud to say I was at an event last week with Mayor Emanuel, and we were talking about Chicago Union Station. And after the event, two reporters came up to me at two different times from two different areas and said, whatever you're doing, continue to do it. We're getting a lot better. Now, I don't want to slant anything towards media, but if you can get a good compliment out of media, you've done something. So trust me, you will never get me to part with that saying, because when they come up and say you've done a good job, I'm taking that to the bank. I might even have it bronzed. But anyway, last but not least, as far as customer service, I think most of the people in the room know we signed a new agreement with the Uber company. It's a three-year agreement, and what it is, it's a rideshare partnering. It's mostly for advertising, because what we wanted to do is make sure that our customers know that there's the opportunity, especially when you get out into the suburbs, down in the city. Dorval does a great job when we bring people into the city. You got the CTA buses, you got the L, you've got taxis, you got a lot of things. But when you get out in the suburbs and it radiates further out there, it's not quite as easy. So when you get up by Lake Cook Road and you got Abbott Labs, and that's just one of many, many growing areas up there, we want to be able to get people to our trains back and forth pretty easily. And we think by us partnering with them, we're going to be able to make that and grow that. And so that's we're very excited for that. Next, I want to talk about investing in our workforce. That's very important. 22% of our workforce is eligible to retire by 2019. That's an amazing number, isn't it? About 16% on the administration side, close to 16% on the professional side, and about 45% of our skilled craft. That's why we have very aggressive apprenticeship programs going on right now. We've got to train people now today for the future. Even though we think we're going to be around forever, we're not always going to be around forever. And you got to have the person, the number twos, the number threes, be able and be prepared to step up to the next challenge. And that's what we're doing right now. We want to invest in our outreach into the communities. We want our organization to really reflect the complexion of what's out there, you know, what communities you're operating through. That's the way you can really have an all-inclusive system and people will be on board and work together. We also want to enhance our programs that we have for development. We've started a lot of in-house professional development programs, and also we've sent people outside for professional development programs. That's important. You want people to understand what the challenges are out in the environment. Dorville, you and I and several other people worked on a lead program, you know, for the next, like, C-suite people. Whether you're going to be a CEO or a deputy executive director or what you're going to be, there's not a lot of us out there, believe it or not. You want to be able to train people and make sure they're ready to step into the next challenge, and that's what we're doing. So we're completing that, I think it's in April, May, in Boston. And what that was is we sent people all over the East Coast railroads and commuter lines, transit lines, the Chicago, you know, to let them go out there for a week, kick the tires, see, ask questions, understand it. What are we doing better? What are they doing better? You know, just so they can get a much more rounded background of what they're up against, because these jobs aren't as easy as one might think. You know, they're pretty tough in a lot of cases. I want to talk a little bit about safety. I shouldn't say a little bit, but this is a little bit in the grand scheme of things. I started by saying safety is at the core fabric, every thread of what we do. If we don't operate a safe system, we shouldn't be operating the system at all. One of the things that we're very proud of, in 16, we became the first railroad with the most comprehensive, confidential close call reporting. I talked about that a little bit last year. We call it C3RS. The airlines industry and aerospace industry has used this for a long time. The railroads have not quite embraced that challenge, and we have done that at Metra. What that does, it looks at trends rather than accidents. Railroads are pretty rigid. You know, if you have something that goes wrong, you go out there, you investigate it, you find out who did what, and you hold people accountable in hopes that it won't happen again. But that really didn't solve the problem, because every time you have a situation, you're going back out there and doing the same thing. What you want to do is look at trends, and you want people that are out in the field. Who knows most about the railroad and the operation? It's the guys that are out there running the trains and doing the things and meeting the people and experiencing things, knowing who's cutting corners and not cutting corners. What this program allows us to do, it allows people to report things without ever having to work about any retribution or anything else. It's actually being managed with the FRA through NASA, actually the aerospace industry. So when we get the information back, we don't know that Don did something or Leanne did something or somebody else. We know that something happened, and if you start to look at trends, can you stop those trends before they happen? Do you need better equipment? Do you need education? What do you need to make sure that those trends aren't out there? So that's very important. One of the other things that we looked at, we have our police department, and for years we manned our own control center and things like that. We had sworn police officers doing that. What our chief said, you know, most of the other people are out there, what they do is they privatize that or put that in someplace else where you don't have sworn police officers doing that, and it would free up some of the police officers. So what we've been able to do is we signed an agreement with Cook County. Cook County is now taking our calls and dispatching our police crews, and we've been able to take all the police that were involved in the control center and put them out in the field riding trains and doing things where our customers see it and they're actually making a difference. And we've gotten a lot of compliments, people seeing, and you've probably seen our police department out there with the dogs and different things and riding trains and at stations. That's really, it makes a big impact. It really stops things from happening in most cases. I'll talk a little bit about PTC in the next slide. That's one of our big safety initiatives. The other thing is the inward-facing cameras for operating crews. This is going to be mandated. It's coming. We're actively working on installing or actually going out for bid to find, you know, a good solution for our system. And what that does is it actually photos, it takes a video of the engineer and all the people in the operating crew. So if something would go wrong, rather than trying to piece it together and everything else, you know exactly what happened. This is a little bit of a of a shock for some of our people, much like drug testing in the industry and things like that. But once people get used to it and they understand it, it could be the best thing in the world. We've been able to really convince, or not really convince, but stand up and stand behind our employees when things go wrong, because if you're doing the right things, it's going to back you 1,000%, because we all know when something happens, it's everybody else's fault, not necessarily the person that actually did it. It's the train crew, it's the engine crew, it's this. This allows us to be able to look at it and really, really back our employees when they're doing the right thing. I'll talk a little bit about body cameras. I think our police department, our police force is about 115 men strong, and we're going to be outfitting our police department with body cameras. We think it's a thing that we should be doing in the future with everything that's going on out in society. We want to be able to make sure that we provide the best equipment for our employees, especially when you're looking at security issues. They're dealing with some pretty tough situations sometimes. We read about it all the time, but we want to be able to back our police department and make sure that everybody understands when an incident does happen, what exactly happened. I told you I wouldn't miss PTC. We put this slide up here to make it easy. I hope you can understand it. The purpose of this slide, as simple as we've tried to make it, it's not simple. It's not easy. It's pretty tough to do. But the real key is when you look up at this slide, you can see everything talking to each other. You see a satellite out there sending a signal to a train, a train sending it to wayside units and things like that. That's what our PTC is. PTC is a system that will stop a train when an engineer does not make a decision that the computer system feels that he should be making. Meaning, if I've got to come up to a 40 mile an hour slow order and I'm going 79, and I'm not taking the right action to slow that train and stop it where I need to, the system will first warn and then it'll take a corrective action. That's really what the system does in a nutshell. When we go through these slides, I want to show you a couple things. Look at the dark blue line. That's our Rock Island line. And we usually use the Rock Island line as our test bed. And what I say that is we own the Rock Island line. There's a minimal amount of freight on there. We can do things and test at all different times of day and night without interfering with a lot of things. Roll it out, get it ready to go for mainstream, and then you start working through your other systems so you don't bring everything to a screeching halt. Those of you that are in IT, when you go and you do some things and you think and you push the button, everything's going to work well, and it doesn't. Now everybody's scrambling. So this is kind of the test bed. First I want to show you here is the X's are our interlockers. Next we're going to show you the wayside antennas. Then we're going to show you the wayside servers. And then we're going to show you the wayside interface units. Now if you look at that and populated that whole system, the map that we have up there, and that's only a small part of it. That's not the onboard computers. That is not the back office, that's not the communication link, it's part of the communication link, but you can just imagine, in the slide I showed you, if you can go back to the previous slide, that's talking to one train. Remember I said we have 1,300 trains in the Chicago territory. Can you imagine the communications going back and forth, trying to communicate where this train is at, by the foot, by the inch, and what we're gonna do? So the system is pretty complex. As usual, this was an unfunded mandate, and you know, a place like Metra, we've got all kinds of money, so we weren't worried about that. It's $400 million, and that $400 million is no cheap price tag. When you start looking at numbers that large, and you start looking at safety, and you know, are you investing your money in your signals, your track, your infrastructure, your bridges, and now you've got PTC. I don't want anyone to leave the meeting and don't think that I think PTC isn't critically important. It is. I just wanted to make the point. It's a $400 unfunded mandate, and it's something that we've got to work with and also keep everything else floating. Over the last couple years, we've renovated 70 cars and 7 locomotives. In 2016, we've implemented a construction program including more than $200 million in capital investments. That include 21 stations, or 27 stations, 21 bridge, and 30 railroad crossings. Just for the sake of perspective, once again, the Metra system is 241 stations, 823 bridges, 570 railroad crossings. So it really is a massive amount of money that we spend on our infrastructure. Next, I want to show you a slide. This is really a cool slide. Look at that. That's our Fox River Bridge. That's what we call in our industry the Z100 Bridge. But what that just means is it's the Fox River Bridge. There's main lines on both sides. And there's two main lines. It goes down to single track, and there's two main lines on the other side. The bridge was built in the late 1800s, 1870-something, I believe it was. What we're going to be doing is we're going to be putting on the picture on the right to the left. You can see there's room for another track. And what we're going to be doing with that is we're going to be putting in a new bridge, and then we're going to be taking that bridge out and then putting a new bridge alongside of it to get rid of one of our big choke points. We never schedule trains to meet there at the same time. That would be kind of silly. But what happens when you have something where your train is running 5 or 10 minutes late? Now all of your meets are off everywhere, right? So where do you think the odds are that we have problems? Just anybody think it might be where you have a single track and you can't get through there? And that's absolutely what it is. I want to thank now Senator Duckworth for all the work that she has done, because we were the recipients of a little over a year ago for the Tiger Grant. We've tried this bridge 5 times, I believe it was, before we actually received a Tiger Grant for it. And it was really a match made in heaven, because we worked with the CP, Metra money, and then as a match, and then we were able to get the Tiger Grant. So that bridge is going to be about $34 million. But when we're done, the people along the West Line are going to have a much more robust schedule and on-time performance. So we won't have to worry about that in the future. Next, we're going to talk about the Ravenswood Bridges. This is the UP. And these bridges were built in 1896 and 1897. We finished the first 11 bridges, grace to Balmoral. Now what we're going to, and half of the Ravenswood Station, now we're coming back to do the other side. So we're going to do the other 11 bridges. When those are done, we're going to flip to the next track and do 11 and 11. We had a pretty aggressive schedule in the beginning on this, and what it did, because of the spans and crossovers, it was causing a lot of heartburn for our UP riders up on that line. So what we had to do is go back, re-engineer it, and throttle it back. So we still needed to maintain the on-time performance. Dorval, I've said before, my hat's off to you when you closed down the red line out there. That was a project, and you were able to support it with buses and things. We didn't have this option. Trust me, if we did, it would be so much nicer, because you can get things done so much quicker and less expensive, but you got to play the hand you're dealt, and that's where we're at right now with that. We're going to continue to modernize Metra's fleet. If you look at the cars on the left and the locomotive on the right, that's being done. The locomotive is being done at our 49th Street facility. And those cars are being rehabbed at our 47th Street, and the cars are the 49th Street facility. We're rehabbing those. I'm going to get into that a little bit later and go a little bit more in depth on what we're doing. But you can just imagine the work that it takes to rehab some of those cars. We're also pursuing the purchase of 21 new rail cars from VRE. VRE signed a contract several years ago. They actually are in the process now where we've actually piggybacked on that and got that. We're working with Nippon Sharyo. Hopefully we can get something together with them to purchase those 21 cars at a reduced rate. I'll fill you in more on that later or next time I speak. Right now we're still in the negotiation stages and that, so I can't really go too much into that. One of the things I wanted to share with everybody here, we all heard about the Volkswagen settlement. And the Volkswagen settlement, many of the states are getting X amount of money depending on how many cars were sold and things like that. Dorval, I'm going to try to beat you on this one. we feel we're a very good candidate to get that money. Right now, I believe there's around $128 million. We all heard about Union Station, the emissions and different things like that, the older locomotives that we operate. it's a match made in heaven for this type of an opportunity to purchase new Tier 4 locomotives to reduce the emissions in the station. Some of these locomotives will reduce emissions by about 90%. So if you look at those numbers, those are staggering numbers. So I just think that we are a very good candidate to, work on trying to get some of that funding for that. I talked a little bit about the 49th Street facility. I want you to pay particular attention to this slide because the building doesn't look much different. The cars may. This facility was put in back in 1947 before the expressway right next to it was put in. Kind of give you a little bit of an idea of what the building was and what we're doing with it today. Currently, Metra houses the rehab program in there to rebuild our cars. This is the facility today. As we go through some of these slides, you're going to see workers back in the 50s, early 50s, and then you're going to see some of the newer things that we're doing right here. Now, I just want to bring everybody's attention to this. Back then, there was no RTA. There was no combining things. If you were on the Milwaukee, you were on the Milwaukee. If you were on the Rock Island, you were on the Rock Island. If you were on the, back then, Chicago Northwestern, so you didn't fix everybody's cars. We're fixing all the cars for the system at that facility today, and it wasn't designed to do anything close to what we're doing. So we want to invest in that facility to increase the throughput on the cars. We want to move it from 35 cars being rebuilt there to 60 cars a year. That's going to help us get our arm around the state of good repair needs. The design work is expected to be completed in the construction, later on in 18, but we're going to be doing all the design work here today. We've allocated about $20 million in funding to start the design work on that. So we're pretty excited about that. I want to talk a little bit about the UP third main line. The BN runs an excellent service. They have three main lines all the way from Aurora into Chicago. We have close to that on the UP line, except for there's two sections. You see the section in yellow. I know it's hard. When I look back in the back before, it was a little harder to decipher that. But if you look at the right-hand side where it says 1.8-mile gap and then the 6.1-mile gap, those are two sections that we're working with the UP on to complete those. We're expecting to start the project up around 25th Avenue the second quarter. In the fourth quarter, we're expecting to start the other project, the 6.1 mile project. That project alone is about $118 million that we're sharing with the UP in order for us to get the fluidity of that line. We run about 60 trains a day. Right now, they're running about 50, but that's their lifeblood from Omaha and out west into the city, into Chicago, and transfer from other railroads. So that's a very important line for us to make sure that we keep the line open in that. Next thing I want to talk about is ensuring financial stability. I think all of us in business here today would like to know that the organization is financially stable. So one of the things that we're doing, when Director Carlson actually came on board several years back, he's an accountant, and he's right into the numbers. You wouldn't expect anything different. And he's trying to figure out, well, what financial system are we using? And when he found out we were using a financial system from the bankrupt Rock Island Railroad that went bankrupt in 1980, which I started my career there, he said, we gotta fix this. Yes, you're right, we do. And we've spent a lot of time and resources on trying to make sure that we're implementing an ERP system that's the right ERP system for us that we can do. We've dedicated high-level resources, senior managers and things, to work with everybody in order to put it together, because what we didn't want to do is put people that didn't really have that good base background in and build a system and find out that it doesn't work. We want to build a system that everybody's got their arms around and it's going to work for us for now and the future. A couple other things I wanted to talk about is the cost-benefit analysis, the fare structure study, and the station optimization. Those are pretty important projects for us. The cost-benefit analysis Metra has got approximately 30 projects out there, and they divide it up into about 15 and 15. 15 is what, this is our core system. What do we have in the core system? What can we do to increase ridership? What can we do to get us into a better state of good repair? And the other 15 are, what about expansions? What about different things like that? So when we looked at it, not that we aren't in the business to try to expand and do what we need to do, but I use this example all the time. We've got to fix our infrastructure. It's critical to what we're doing. You know, if you had a house and the foundation was leaking and the roof is leaking, you're not going to put a new garage on. You're going to fix the foundation and fix the roof. And that's what we need to do. Part of that study is going to look at if we made an investment, how would that investment perform? So we know when we're dealing with the scarce dollars and resources that we have, what are we doing? How can we make an investment? What will give us the biggest bang for the buck? Is it ridership? Is it revenue? What is it? So those are some of the things we're working on right now, and that study should be done in the near future. Our fare structure study, we're looking at our fares. Our fares have been this way forever. We have a zone-based fare system. Every 5 miles, you go into another zone. Director or actually Chairman Carlson said at the Sandhouse Gang the other day, you know, this goes back to the 1800s when we were looking at these things. I wasn't around the 1800s. I have to take his word for it. But really, the bottom line on it is, does it make sense to have a fare structure like that? Should it be a flat fare? Should it be congestion pricing? Should it be when someone gets on the train during the rush hour or the peak? Should that be a higher price? Should it be a lower price? What it should it be? So we've got a study to help us guide us through those issues and those things right now, and we're hoping that we can if we make changes, it's going to drive more ridership to the trains. There's certain times and certain areas that we have a lot of capacity, and there's other times where we have very little capacity. Coming into the city on most of the lines, and I say most, not all, you're pretty much full to capacity. Your reverse commute, there's plenty of capacity. On the shoulders, you know, there's capacity. So what can we do to really drive those numbers down and do some of the things that make it better for us and make it more advantageous for customers to take Metra? Station optimization. Station optimization is nothing more than something that we've done in the past. Those of you that are familiar with our Milwaukee West Line, we had a station out there that was, or two stations that were, you know, Hermosa and Cragen. We work with the communities to look at it and say, look it, we want to invest in this area, but having these two underperforming stations might not be the solution, it might not be the best. What can we do? And out of those collective thoughts, Grand Cicero Station was born. You have one station, you combine the two, you had a new station, better lighting, safer station, it was enhancing what we can do. That's kind of what we're doing with some of the things we're looking at. Do we need stations in other places? Do we not need stations? Do we need to combine them? I don't want anyone to think we're just looking at getting rid of stations. What we're trying to do is apply our resources where it makes the most sense so we can keep up with it and grow our system. That's what we're really trying to do. I don't think I need to say too much about some of our challenges. I can't talk to a group like this without sharing with everybody some of the problems that we have in funding, and these are the RTA numbers, so I just didn't make them up for your entertainment. The bottom line on it is, over the next 10 years, we've got $11.7 billion shortfall in the state of good repair needs. And if you look at that and you say, what can you do to get out of it? We would need about $1.2 billion a year. $1.2 billion a year, and it's broken up almost 50-50. Not quite, but for this conversation, 50-50. 50% of that would be taking care of our backlog, getting us into a state of good repair. The other 50% of that would be maintaining what we have so we don't fall into a state of disrepair. So out of the $1.2 billion, we end up getting anywhere from $275 to $300 million a year. I'm not really good at math, but if you take 3 from 1.2, you're left with a $900 million shortfall. So everything that we're doing to try to keep us in the right area and try to do the right things, we're still losing ground, folks. We are still losing ground, and that's a problem, and that's why we need to work with everybody to find a solution so we can, come out of this and make sure our system is performing today and in the future for what we need. Our fares are going up on February 1st. I think everybody's aware of that. The board elected, and through a lot of consternation going back and forth, because we never take increasing our fares lightly. We look at it that it's an important thing to do. We think that it is. We got to keep up with our needs. But the fares on average are going up about 5.8%. And what we're going to do with that money is not a single penny, I'm proud to say, not a single penny is being spent on operating this year. Every dime, every single penny is being spent on rebuilding cars, rebuilding locomotives, working on signal systems, working on tracks, working on infrastructure. I can't tell you how proud I am of the team. When they got to make some tough decisions, and we start out January 1st of every year, we hit the reset button, not the easy button, the reset button, and we say, when things come up, do we need it? What benefit does it have? What will happen if we don't have it? So we can make every decision and look at every penny that we have so we can invest it wisely. So just wanted to share that with you, that we're doing real well when it comes to that. One of the things that I need to touch base on, our new board chairman has asked us in 2017 to look at having, by the end of 2018, a new strategic, long-term strategic business plan together, and that's what we're going to do, which is a little bit different than the 10-year modernization we had a few years back. It's really the guiding principle of what we're going to be doing in the future and that. So we expect to have this done by year's end, like we were asked to do. And that's pretty much all I have. I'd like to thank our employees. These are the men and women that make our jobs easy, because they're providing the good service out there, so we have trains that run on time that don't fail. Not saying that they never fail or not, they always run on time. But when you look at the size and the magnitude, we couldn't do it without our workforce. So I'm very, very proud of them, and I don't ever miss a chance to tell everybody what a great workforce we have. I'm going to leave you with one last thing. Despite the tremendous financial challenges we have the oldest fleet in the industry, we continue to have the fewest mechanical failures, the best on-time performance, and the lowest fares compared to our peers, and we're very proud of that. Thank you for inviting me here today. Remember, Dorval, we got a deal.
Yes. Great job. How about another round of applause for Don? His team is doing a great job. And everybody should get a picture of the CJA president saying that, okay? You can frame that one on your wall in your office. I actually don't have that many questions, so your presentation must have been very thorough.
Well, thank you. Or I bored them to death and they want to get back.
Let me give you this first one. This is from Alderman Joe Moore. What are your plans to replace the bridge on the UP North line north of Ravenswood? And do you have any plans to upgrade the Rogers Park Metro Station?
Well, I will have to get back with you on the bridge. We've got a lot of bridge projects going on. Are you talking about the Deering Bridge or what?
Actually, bridges, plural.
Oh, I think I talked about that. What we're doing is we're going to finish the 11 bridges we got going on right now. Then we're going to go back and do another 11 and another 11 right after that. Is that what you're talking about? Moving on, yes. No, as soon as we get funding, we'll rebuild every bridge that we have. Let's work together on this. But I'll tell you what, we look at our bridges, at what do they need, how old are they, what type of condition are they in, and when we looked at the bridges, out there, what we looked at was, what do we need to replace right away? So if you're asking about a different set of bridges, I would have to go back with our engineering folks and see what it is, but I'd be more than happy to get that information for you. Thank you, Joe.
Okay, the questions are starting to come in, so.
Question period is over.
Here's one from the Active Transportation Alliance. What is your vision for improving suburb-to-suburb transit service?
Suburb-to-suburb transit service, are you talking about train-to-train transit service? Is that what we're talking about? In other words, suburb-to-suburb with a train? Or are we talking about, with bikes and things like that? Well, we always work with the CTA and PACE to look at different routes that we have and what makes sense. I think when we looked at the Uber contract that we just signed, we're trying to connect people with mainstream railroad transportation and getting them to wherever they need to go. I think that's going to be a good thing. I think our system will only grow to what we'd like it to be if we do provide seamless transportation or part of a seamless transportation link to connect people with, employment, connect people with opportunities to connect, just different social events, whether they're downtown or whether they're out in the area.
Okay, Steve Schlickman has
gotta
a question.
Steve. You
gotta love
Steve.
Steve. Where are you?
Steve.
Former head of RTA, all right. Metra took the courageous and necessary step, you still sound like you're running RTA, to increase fares to fund its capital needs. Are you issuing bonds against that revenue, and what projects are you looking to fund?
Well, that's a good question. When I was here last time, we talked about, whether we were going to issue bonds, what we were going to do, and I'm not saying that we are or aren't. We are investigating it. Right now we're going through the process that we could issue bonds, but, we might look at it. It doesn't make any difference if it's a bond or some type of financing mechanism that makes it the best financial decision for the organization. It could be leasing. It could be private financing. It could be a lot of different things, but we are working on that, Steve.
Thank you. John Trotta from Parsons Brinkerhoff asks, if earmarks were to come back, what might be your priorities? That's a tricky question, so think about that one, okay?
I really can't prioritize any one project. We have many, many, many needs. And like I said, when we talked about the spaghetti bowl, and all the projects that we have, some of the decisions that are going to come out of there are going to help us make the right decisions, and we'll work with our board what we should go ahead and move forward in the future. But whatever it is, it's going to be data, driven decisions and what we think we need to move forward. Thank you.
Two more? Unfortunately, I only have two more left. That was good. Tell us more about your partnership with Uber. Is this solution, do you believe that this is the solution to the last mile?
I don't believe it's the only solution, but it's a tool in the toolbox. And what we need to do is figure out, because whether it's Uber or Lyft or some other company, we signed an agreement with Uber. We think that a lot of people know Uber, and we're going to advertise together and things like that in order to make people aware of it. There's probably some things out there that'll come up next year or the year after that we aren't even thinking about today. 10 years ago, when you talked about Uber, it wasn't really, it didn't really land yet, right? In a lot of the major areas. Now it's a major player. A lot of people look at Uber as, and I deal with this at APTA also. Is Uber good? Is Uber bad? Is it this? Is it that? And I can only look at companies that were very, very prosperous companies 10 years ago today. And if you drove by them, or 10 years ago, you drove by them today, and they aren't even there anymore. So you got to keep an open mind. You got to work on solutions that fit your customer needs. That's why we're so customer focused. If we can't deliver what our customers are looking for, whether it's Wi-Fi, whether it's new seats, whether it's the Ventra app, our customers are going to leave what we're doing, and we don't want that. I think there's plenty of space for Uber and the trains and things like that. Let's face it, if you're coming from the outskirts and you're getting in an Uber and you're on a congested highway, what does that solve? You're not going anywhere. If you drive people to the mainstream and you work together and get a business plan and a solution, it's much better for everybody.
Couldn't agree more with that. Final question. Are you planning to have train service to Rockford? You aren't going to get my $1 billion.
Well, then the deal's off. We're looking at all different kinds of things, but I got to be very honest with you. When you look at, we're funded by the six counties, and we've got a lot of infrastructure needs right here. And I think I stated when we talked about the spaghetti bowl map, what do we need to fix our infrastructure? What do we need to be robust? What do we need to plan for the future? What do we need to have for our children, our grandchildren, and their children as a transportation system? I think once we get further along, we'll be able to make some decisions. Our board will have to weigh in on it, and there are a lot of people that will have to work with the RTA. When you start getting outside of the RTA, how do you become part of the RTA? How do you fund it? Is the funding going to be there for just capital? And then you've got the O&M, the operation and maintenance costs. It's pretty complex, but right now we're focusing right now on our core business.
Give a round of applause.